Okay. Do we have an assignment due today? Let's see. The assignment one is due today, and I gave you programming assignment 1.1 last week, so which is due next week, right? So, okay, we still have time. So that gives us, again, for the midterm, I'm not so sure at this point about the midterm schedule. Probably end of October, most likely. Or, depends on how we progress, there's a chance there's going to be a first week of November, but I try to make it as the end of the October. And I'm guessing that usually during the midterm week, we don't have a class, but I'm thinking about having a class and then exam. And that's what I'm thinking at this point. I will let you know by next week or in 2 weeks about that. 수업하고 시험 보고 그래야 될 것 같아요. 아니면 시험을 보고 수업, 그럼 더 싫을 거 아니야. 수업하고 시험을 봐야지. 그렇죠? 보면서 합시다. 사실 중간에 휴일이 없어서 우리는 다른 과목을 보강을 해야 되는 건 없어서. Okay, so I will let you know more about your scheduling in next week. And looking forward to seeing your assignment today. Okay, before I begin, any other questions regarding assignment 1.1, programming assignment? No, not yet. Haven't even started yet, so yeah. Okay, I understand. Just in case, my office hour is next Tuesday in the afternoon. I said 4 to 6, but lots of people having a class at 4 to 6. So I'll be in my office even after 6. So let's say after 6 for about 1 hour. Until I'm in my office, so that's going to be the office hour next Tuesday. Okay, so let's keep up with our slide. Last week we were discussing about sockets and mostly application layers, some of the protocols that you know them, but you never had look at it in the protocol formats. So we did discuss the protocol formats for the DNS part, starting with what is DNS, and then we try to look at some of the protocols, formats of the DNS and other protocols. We also discuss things about P2P, hash keys, distributed hash table approaches, how we organize the peers so we can download the files from the chunk of files from the P2P network. We also did take a look at how they send out the messages in a DHT distributed hash table environment. You have a connection to the peer's ID close to you, and you start sending the messages this way, the circle ways, and then once you find the peers that they have the files that you're looking for, and then they start adding a extra connections like shortcut, and hopefully we can reduce the number of messages that traveling on top of the DH network by log n scale. Otherwise, it's a linear scale to log n scale. We like to minimize the messages that's in and out of the peers, and there are other issues like peer churn ratio, how many peers are appearing, disappearing from time to time. One of the mechanisms to keep it connected is the node is keeping track of the node ahead of you and two another node in front of you, two node in front of you, and then they keep track of the ID numbers. Just in case your neighbor disappear all of a sudden and you still have a connection to the peer in front of them, right? We did take a look at it and we did discuss it briefly on the part. So hopefully we can finish discussing on, we're gonna take a look at some examples on TCP's programming examples that your textbook provide, especially in Java, like, so we did discuss about process having a socket, and then through that socket, it's process-to-process communication is possible. We did discuss it, we look at the figures, but we're going to take a look at the actual programming code to open up your socket and try to send the stream of text data, whatever that you're typing, it will be sending to the another process over a socket that you have created. And when we create a socket, of course, we need to define the port numbers so we can find the right process to communicate. So we're going to take a look at that today. So socket programming with the TCP. TCP first, reliable transfer, UDP, unreliable transfer. This is slightly on transport layer, which is a layer below of the application layer. Client must contact the server. Server process must be running all the time. So client usually initiate the connection. Just same example for the server client, the example for the web servers. Always us as an end user initiate the connection to the server that I wanted to have a connection to. It means that on the server side, there are server process is keep waiting for the connection. Keep waiting for the connection. Later source examples, they actually use a while loop, infinite loop to waiting for the connection from the client side, TCP connection to be more exact. So server process running, must be running. Server must have created socket door, right? We're using a door analogy and numbers in front of each door, smaller holes in the doors. Welcomes the client contact. So assuming that client knows where to contact to, it means they know they must know IP addresses and port numbers of the process they wanted to contact, right? Client contact the server by creating a client local TCP socket. In order to communicate, I also need to create my own socket, right? Specifying IP addresses and port numbers of the server process, neighbor.com's IP address, and we all know that HTTP protocol using a port number 80 to communicate, right? Yeah. That's a given rule. When clients create the socket client TCP, establish a connection to the server TCP. Now it's a TCP over TCP. When contacted by the client, the server TCP create a new socket for server process to communicate with the client. Allow servers to talk with the multiple clients. Source port numbers used to distinguish clients. We're going to take a look at the figures much easier. Sometimes single process can have a multiple port to host a multiple clients. That's depending on how you wanted to design it. So application viewpoint is TCP provide a reliable in-order transfer of the bytes between client and server. In-order means what? If sequence, yeah. So if client send 1, 2, 3, 4, server receiving in order, 1, 2, 3, 4. Likewise, the other way around too. However, in the application layer, we don't care whether the data is arrived in the sequential order or not. Because TCP will take care of that. The actual TCP operation, those datas are not arriving in order. They actually arriving in all kind of order, out of order. TCP will make sure that the upper layer process is thinking that we receive everything in order. So this will come up again when we start discussing for the transferring mechanism in TCP. So client-server socket interaction TCP server, create the socket port number X. So I'm a server, I'm opening up socket port number X, let's say, I don't know, 8020, that's my port number. So client must be connected, contact to the server using port number 8020. Otherwise, client will not be able to find where the server processes are. only even if they probably only have an IP only, but they still won't able to find the process without port numbers. So I create certain socket called welcome socket, server socket, and it's running, waiting for the connections from client, waiting for the incoming connection request, socket to socket process. So at this point, server is doing nothing, and whenever they receive the connection request from the client, they will accept it. They will accept it. Not happened yet. So from the client side, in order to start create, I create my own client socket and then start sending the message. I need to speak to you. But again, in order to find this guy, assuming I know this guy's IP address and port number X, otherwise no connection can be made. I mean, without that information, client doesn't know where to send the message to. So initialization is happening. Set up, send requests using the client socket, and then server was constantly running state for any request from someone else. So as soon as they receive the client socket connection messages, they got it, accept it, and they reply back, I'm alive. I'm ready to make a transfer from this point. And you can exchange messages and you can close the socket whenever your connection is done, right? The idea is quite simple. I mean, we're going to just simply translate this step into a corresponding lines within a code. So some of the terminologies they're going to use in the example, stream is a sequence of characters that flow into or out of the process. So input stream, output stream simply means whatever you're typing in the keyboard. We like to send that information, stream of character, through the socket to the other process. Okay. So that's why they say input stream and output stream. So if I'm a client, I'm connected to the server's socket, and as soon as I start typing something in my keyboard, that stream of characters will be transferred to the server-side socket. So server-side will push that stream into the upper application layer, so users at the server side can take a look at what you're typing. Simple chatting. Examples. So they're going to use the term streaming of the stream of characters.
쉽게 얘기하면 그냥 타입 치는 거 저쪽으로 보내는 거예요. 보내고 받고.
And I think in our example there is only one case. Only clients can send. I didn't take a look at closely the source code that we have in here, but I didn't see any code that servers can reply back to the client with the stream of characters. In this simple server program, servers can only receive stream of characters from client. Examples of a client-server app. Client read the line from a standard input, whatever you're typing, read line one by one, and sends to the server via socket out to the server stream. So client within client's socket, through that socket, sending to the server side socket. Server read the line from the socket, server convert the line into the uppercase, send back to the client. Oh, actually they did send back to the client. So, client read and prints a modified line from the socket. This is the client side example for the Java program. What they describe in the previous page, this step is translated into a Java language here. So as a first timers, when I also did the same when I was doing the first programming assignment, usually they want us to open up the socket, just write a simple program that exchanging a messages, stream of characters. And you don't know where to begin with, this is a good start. You just copy and paste everything of this source code and start modifying this code. I mean, because it's quite, the step is quite similar to any other steps. I mean, in order to create a communication program, you need to create a socket. So they do it. socket, client socket, new socket, host name. If you want, you can put an IP, or typically you put a local host. It's local host usually translate into my IP address in the system. And port number, 6789. So I guess I'm gonna open up the socket that listens to the port number 6789. Okay. Before I do that, this is the part that I'm reading something from your input screen, text mode. Whatever you're typing it, it will be reading into the from a system in. We all know this. It's very similar to the C++ like. So that's why we need a standard input output, JavaNet, TCP client. This way. 여기서 시스템으로 들어오는 거 그냥 받아서 넘기려고 받고 open up my socket. Data output stream to out server. New data out stream client socket gets output stream. So I open up another thing called data output stream. The things to send it to the socket. I'm gonna define it. And I probably, whatever I get it from here, I'm gonna give it to this guy so I can send it over the socket that I open up here. Continue. Oh, sorry, I explained it. Create the input stream, whatever you're typing in. Create a client socket, object type socket, connect to this server. This is server port number. Server port number. Server name, in this case. Create the output stream attached to the socket. I guess if you wanted to just have a server and client program within your system, within the computer itself, you can still use a local name, but you have to define a different port numbers. I think the next chapter will give you a better example on port number, destination port number, and source port numbers. So if you want to do this for fun practice, you can just simply download, copy and paste this code within your own machine using the name of localhost, and you can create your server. This is client program on your PC. And then continue from that previous page. It's gonna read whatever from the input. From the input user, read line by line, one line. If you press enter, it will read it through line by line. And send the line to the server. This is adding an end of character, the space. 뭐지? Space 아니지? End of line character. And then you attach to it, and you will send it to the, so here. Send it line to the server in here. Whatever that you read it from, you send. And read line from the server. Modify the sentence from server read in. They say server will receive whatever that you send. They will convert it to the capitals, and then they will send it back, right? So in this phase, I'm waiting to receive something from the server side. System output from server, I received this. And server client socket closed. What you're seeing is one simple step. I send something, server will change it. We haven't taken a look at the server side code yet. I received it, printed out, and end of connection. So it's not a very smart chatting program. I mean, KakaoTalk, does KakaoTalk start over and over again? Once you send the one message, it will start again? No, right? It's keep asking for more inputs, so it stay online, right? So it's you can take a look at it, very dumb side of client that you're building. For example, Kakao, any chatting applications that you're looking at. So if you want to make this as a, without closing the connections, and you keep doing this, you want to like to get more inputs from the users, from you, and keep sending it whenever that you have a message, then I probably put a while loop all over it before I close it. Infinite loop. We keep waiting for the inputs from the users. That way you can manipulate your program look like a continuous chaining program. Just if you have a free time, just copy and paste and see whether it's working, whether it receives, it sends the data and receives the data from the server program that you're running. 나도 맨날 그렇게 했어요. I also did the same thing. This Java is good. Java, using Java to open up the sockets and close, nothing to worry about. This is a general guideline. You can just do the same for anything. The C, C++, it's a bit more painful. I mean, there, you have a choice that you can use a raw socket or just normal sockets. If you're using a raw socket, then it's, I mean, you have to be really careful for byte sequences that you're sending. Very painful. So, Java는 되게 편해요. Java is much easier to open up. C에서 소켓 열고 막 이러면 C에서 소켓 여는 건 raw 소켓을 열 수도 있고 무슨 TCP 소켓을 열 수도 있고 막 다 달라요. 근데 raw 소켓 같은 거 열면 바이트 시퀀스까지 다 봐야 돼. 여기서 바이트가 하나 삐끗하면 막 그냥 프로그램 죽고 그래요. 그래서 되게 복잡해. Java is good. But if you want, you can try this similar opening up the socket and stuff in Python and any other languages, much more easier languages that you don't have to worry about those type of special sequences like that. So I do recommend to take a look at the samples. I mentioned that most common programming assignment any other networking courses are chatting program, right? So, 제일 먼저 나오는 게 chatting program. You can begin right away by copying it down. Python으로 하면 더 쉬울걸? If you try to do this with a Python or Ruby, opening socket, maybe one line of the code, you can just get an input from one line too. What? How many lines that we have in the client? Maybe 20, 30? Maybe Python less than 5? So, C로 하면 maybe double of this. That in my experiences, there are rare chances that you're opening up your own sockets, you program in this level. Especially working in a company, it's rarely that you'll be opening up your own sockets. Like you're building your own server program. No one building your own server program nowadays. Yeah. 요즘엔 그렇게 잘 안 해. 워낙에 오픈소스 좋은 거 많은데 왜 미쳤다고 소켓 열어가면서 서버 프로그램 만들어요. 좋은 거 많은데. 이거 만들면 여기에 클라이언트 두 명만 붙으면 그냥 뻗을 거예요. So outside of this course, don't do try something funny like you try to build your own web servers using sockets like this. It's not gonna last. There are tons of good open source server programs that you can use that will hold 100,000 people at the same time, nicely organized socket and corner memory management. So don't do stupid things like building your own servers this way. This for fun, okay? This is a server-side TCP connection. So this is class TCP server, blah, blah, blah. I'm opening up a server socket, welcome socket. I'm waiting for, from the server side, I'm opening up port 6789. So client server can contact me through 6789, like the one that we saw in the client side. And while true, infinite loop, it's going to keep waiting for the connection from the client because I don't know when I'm going to receive a connection. So while true, socket connection, socket equals welcome socket, except, so this line will be hanging somewhere around, hanging, until this happens. This happens, I get the input from the client input streams. Read lines from the data that I receive from the client. That's why it says client sentences. Capitalized sentences equals put everything in the uppercase and add an end of character line, end of line character. So it's going to be a sentence looking like. And then out to the client, same way. I'm sending it back to the client. End of while loop, loop back, wait for the another client connection to happen. Go back up, waiting to, until they have a, you have a request and accept it. While loop. So it's a, one of the easy ways to implementing the server ways. However, anywhere, anytime that we use a while loop like that, it's a wasting the process speed memories, and it's not a very efficient way of doing so, right? So if you take a look at the recent versions of like Node.js, Node.js, 뭐 이런 거 혹시 써본 사람? 서버사이드, web server-side platform that you can use. Well, they use a concurrency approaches, so not to using this type of while loop approaches to handle more requests from the client. 혹시 Node.js 할 줄 아는 사람 있어요? Anybody have experience in Node.js? Okay. It's, why do you using a Node.js?
I'm using a
okay. Any particular reason that you choose to use a Node.js?
It's all JavaScript.
Okay. Yeah, but one of the benefits.
One of the mean step.
Yeah. Okay. One of the reasons they choose to use a Node.js is because they take the concurrency approaches. Theoretically, they are faster and can hold more client at the same time. So that's the, one of the powerful things that you can choose. Well, but lots of people choosing it, oh, it's better for me. But I thought it's a bit difficult to understand for the first timers. It's not easy. It's not easy because their programming programming idea is not a sequential way of doing so. It's a jumping around between the different components. So something to maybe if you have a free time over the winter break, something to look into Node.js. 요즘 Node.js 개발자 많이 구한대. There are many companies that are looking for Node.js developers. So it's a, one nice attached to your resume if you're interested. 하긴 뭐 한국에서는 Node.js를 하나 많아. 뭐 상관 안 하겠지만 외국 해외에 취업하고 싶은 사람들은 아마 더 많이 쓸 거예요. 미국이나 이런 데. 우리 아마 Node.js 할 줄 안다 그러면 뭐 하러 하냐 그럴 거예요. 그죠? 뭘 하려고? 시키는 거나 제대로 하지 이럴 거예요. 그래도 나도 익숙하지 않아요. 최근에 나온 거라. 최근은 아닌데 개념이 좀 달라서 나도 해본 적은 없어. 그냥 이렇게 눈팅만 해봤지. 솔직히 말하면 이거 얘네 이렇게 짜는구나. 오케이, okay, that was a TCP way of doing so. I mean. Again, I just wanted to give you more reference on if you wanted to build your own, this is where you can begin. I'm sure your textbook can provide more examples in the actual source code, and I'm sure you can find on the better sample code in the Google. Just type socket opening Java in Google, then you will have a plenty of sample code that you can just follow through. You might be able to just find the chatting program right away in every other languages that you can find. Socket with the UDP, same, it will be much more simpler. There is no waiting steps, at least for the client, right? Well, server-side, server-side, there must be waiting, but there are less pain because in this way, they know, they're not doing any connection negotiations. You just send and forget. So I don't think I provide the source code in this slide, but just for the concept. UDP, no connection between client and server, no handshaking. Handshaking mechanism, we'll discuss more when we start discussing TCPs. Sender explicitly attach IP addresses and port destination to each packet, blah, blah, blah. Server must extract IP address and port sent from a server packet. UDP, transmitted data may be received out of order or lost. That is the major difference from TCP, right? We're gonna take a look at this more once we cover the transport layer. So I'm gonna skip it in this part. It's pretty much same at this point for the UDP and TCP. So I think I did summarize it at the beginning of the class today. plan, P2P, hybrid, reliability, bandwidth, delays, and etc. TCP, we're going to discuss that more, UDP, some sample protocols, application layer protocols that you might know, but I gave you certain examples on if you really wanted to look at how those things are formatted in terms of in bits and bytes, there are RFC documents that you can certainly take a look at to study more. Port numbers, I try to give you some ideas for the firewalls because all these type of application layer protocols are having a certain port numbers to communicate. So one of the ways that you can control your network is port number is one of the basic ones that you can do, right? Control in-band, out-of-band. Okay, I think that was for the FTP, centralized, decentralized, stateless, stateful. Stateless, stateful, where was this discussed? Where was it? Stateless, stateful, what's it? TCP connection. TCP connection, it is stateful, but I think we mentioned in the HTTP server, like HTTP protocol, from server side, they don't keep a track of the state of the clients. TCP, because he bring it up, TCP, yes, it will keep a track of the state in order to provide a reliable communication later with the small example, with the example of finite state machines that we're gonna take a look. Complexity at the network edge. We like to keep the core simple, even though we haven't discussed too much about routings. all the job will be given to your PCs, your end client processes. Let's move into the transport layer, which have all the answers to this slide. Well, five, transport layer. Finally, some useful stuff. TCP, transport layer services. So transport layer, let's see. The first few part is pretty much repeating what the application layer was saying. Transport layer services and protocols provide a logical connection between app and processes. Well, to be more clear, process-to-process communication. If we go into IP layers, it's more IP to IP communication. It means that I don't care which router is below. I don't care which path they took. Only thing that I care is if this guy is talking to this guy, I only see one path. That's what I mean by logical connection. Logical connection. Even though there is only one logical connection, below this logical connection, there will be a very small steps, hops, to the routers and switches. However, that's actually physical connection like. We're gonna take a look at more on the transport layer level connections. So it's going to be a single line. Like this. Transport layer communicating directly to the transport layer. So that's sometimes called end-to-end connections, edge-to-edge. This is possible again because we are taking layering architecture. I don't care what's happening below, layer below me. I'm assuming everything in this layer is working fine. So they do whatever they need to do. So I can only focus on this logical connections only. Provide the logical communication between apps, processes running on different hosts, right? Process to process communication. Not a host to host communication yet. Host-to-host communication is IP to IP. Here, IP port to IP port. So process-to-process communication. 그지? IP 대 IP면 그냥 호스트 간의 거고 뭐 거의 비슷하긴 하지만 사실 process-to-process communication이니까 포트 넘버가 들어가야 되네. Transport protocols run in the end system. Sending side, break the app messages from the application layer into a segment. The diagram that we have seen, smaller boxes will actually break it out into smaller ones that will have a header, small header boxes will be attached to. passed to the network layer. So whatever they're given in the message become a segment, and it will be moving down into the network layer. Server side, receiver side, do the exact backward. Whatever they receive from the network layer, make the segment, and they push it back to the, push it top to the application layer messages. So more than one transport protocol available to receiver side reassembles the segment into messages passed to the upper layer, application layer. We're gonna call that as a multiplex and demultiplex in the later slide. I often get a question on what does this mean to break it down the messages and etc. My own way of explaining is this. If you're chatting application, let's say it's chatting application. So it's a chat application layer. And the transport layer, let's say I'm TCP. So in your application, your programs, you're typing, I don't know, hello, John. This is the message that I type it into, for example, KakaoTalk. So I need to send it to the other server through that. So in the transport layer, it says break it down, right? Maybe this is too long. So I break it into two parts. Hello and John. And every time I break it to, I need to attach a message. This is a message ones, message twos. And at this level in here, I'm going to say IP addresses of that I'm sending and port number. IP address of port that I'm sending and port number. But to be more exact, network layer will attach a IP addresses. In the network layer, we use IP. So maybe I can even break down even more smaller. John AH L low separate box like that. And every message will have another header like that. Another header. Header. And keep doing it. And send these little components one by one, smaller boxes like that, to whatever the receiver side. Receiver received it, network layer. They start reassembled. So LO become a one box, but the network layer is still the same. HN. And then when I need to pass into the transport layer, I would reassemble. It become a hello, John. Upper layer, where actual users will take a look at this message, will bring it back. Hello, John. Of course, we're going to do an exact backwards, so headers that have will be disappear as we go up. So in this header information, they have all the information how to combine these two, like offsets, like this is first, and then next one, two, like this part. This is what we try to discuss. Of course, this is a much simpler example. The actual breakdown of the messages is not this simple. Maybe in terms of bytes. Later we're gonna break down into in terms of bytes. If this message is small enough, maybe we don't need to break it down. We can just fit into everything. So, but typically application layer messages are large. So, 뭐 몇 개만 치면 it's usually over up to a couple megabytes. But at the bottom here, there are limitations of this size. So based on this size that you need to break it down at the end. So that's a big picture like. That's why you say break it down, reassemble a receiver, client, server. Sender.
맞지? Sender. And in this way, we can use a TCP here or UDP here. Depends on the cases. Transport versus network layers. Network layer, local communication between host, IP to IP. Transport layer, logical communication between processes, IP and port numbers to IP and port numbers, right? Well, if you wanted to really make a difference, that's the part that we need to, that's using it to. And this is a textbook notion of try to give you better ideas of what's the difference between the two, but it's really bad, so don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. 이거 더 헷갈려. I try to read it every year. It's more confusing than necessary. So but try to keep up with these examples. Okay. Anyway, we're going to take a look at more examples later. Reliable in-order delivery, TCP. Oh, well, I try to give you idea for congestion control, flow control, right? It will be revisited anyways, but congestion control, there are too many things in the middle, so we like to reduce it down. Flow control, your receiver cannot receive more than what they are allowed. So sender will reduce the speed of the sending ratio, and et cetera, et cetera. So TCP is much more complex compared to the UDP. No free extensions, no unnecessary stuff. Send, socket, open socket, connection, send, done. Right? In the actual TCP socket, they actually try to keep it off the simple way of looking at it. If this guy sent four receiver, and when they send these four, this one will keep asking, do you receive all four? And receiver tell this guy, yes, I received one, two, three, but not four. Then this one will figure out, oh, the receiver just sent me the message that they only received one, two, three. So it means that four somewhere in the between disappear or didn't deliver on time, so I need to send four again. That makes it reliable, right? Without letting the application know. Try to imagine that you try to implement that. You try to write a program checking for that stuff. It's quite complex. There are many cases that you may not think of, like actual four disappear in the between, or when they receive, when they send me the message that 1, 2, 3 got here, as soon as they send me the message, four gets there. So they didn't have time to send me the message that four received. What are you going to do? Are you going to send it again? Or are you going to ask them again whether they have a four? Right? There are many, many choices that you can make. So, 그걸 프로그램을 한다고 생각해봐. You try to program that, covering all those minor cases. It's a very difficult, it's a very annoying thing to cover in TCP sockets side. But regardless of whether you're using TCP or UDP, one thing stays the same, no delay guarantee, no bandwidth guarantees. Right? No delay guarantee, no bandwidth guarantees. That's a basis of a best effort service, the internet current structure. We're not discussing a circuit-based internet, right? So TCP, UDP, probably the biggest challenge. TCP is the biggest challenge in the transport layer. Multiplexing and demultiplexing. Multiplexing, demultiplexing. We use a different term. Okay. Demultiplexing and receiving host. Delivery, receive the segment to the correct socket. Up, finding the right one to give. Up, demultiplexing. Multiplexing and sending host. Gather the information from a multiple socket. Envelop data within header. Envelop with the header. Multiplexing. It's a fancy term to use, multiplex and demultiplex. Where do you hear this term, multiplex and demultiplex? 어디서 나와? 어디서 나와? 그지? Circuit 하고 컴구역에 나오자 하죠. 뭐 select 하고 막 나오잖아. 그냥 그건 잊어버려요. Don't worry about it here. 그냥 이름만 갖다고 봐. 귀찮으니까.
So this is a bit better diagram than mine. So here's the host 1, 2, 3. I guess host 2 is a server-like. So host 1 is a some application try to send a message to the server host 2, process 1. This one is a process, referring to a process. This yellow box is socket. So it means that I have all the right numbers to go to process 1. Process 4 on host 3 are talking to this guy through the socket here. How demultiplexing work? Host receive the IP datagrams. IP datagrams. Each datagram has a source IP addresses and destination IP addresses. So in the header here, written that where this datagram is come from. So source IP field probably have a sender's IP names, and destination IP field IP addresses are mine. The source and destination IP are written in every packet, every datagram that is being exchanged. IP source port is 2 byte, right? 16 bits each. Source port, destination port, 32 bits, so wide, 4 bytes long, right? Segment formation. Datagram formation, it's below where the IP address is written. Okay. Each datagram carries one transport layer segment. So where IP address is written, they're going to carry this one on top of it. Each segment has a source, destination, and port numbers. Host use a IP addresses and port numbers to direct segment to the appropriate socket. Like I told you, you need to know the port numbers to go to the right process. This sounds fancy, right? So it's always easier to take a look at the examples. Like, I'm sure everyone knows the Wireshark. Some people probably have already done it from the other courses. So this, hopefully you can see it. This is one of the packets that I capture, or I can capture one now. So this is a Wireshark. Your textbook probably giving you a small exercise using this tool to capture packets, datagrams, and they try to give you the actual formats that we have discussed last week and today. So if I start capturing the packets on certain interface, right now I'm connected to Hanyangin. There are 22 packets coming in, 23, 29. So if I web surf, more data will be generated from my machine to the server side. Just in case, I will start capture. At the same time, I will open up the web browser. Give me a website. Naver. Naver 돈 많이 벌겠다. Naver.com. Done. I close it. And then I will stop capturing. It means I have captured a 1,000 packets that in and out of my PCs to the Naver. And I probably just wanted to see a TCP packet only. That's what I'm looking for. So I'm going to just say TCP. And these are all the TCP datagrams packet, but I usually use the term packets in and out of my system now. I think 172.17.21 is 아마 저게 네이버인 것 같아. Our school is 172. Like, 아니다. I don't know the actual. Yeah, I think so. So I click one of the packets. It says Internet Protocol version 4. If I click it, it says IP header, IP addresses. Where is my IP addresses? Here. Sorry, it says source IP address is 101.79.242.159. From this source IP to this source IP addresses, they're written all in this format. And this is a hexa code jump of the packets. So you capture all the binary if you do a hexacode dump. So if you translate this part of the message into this decimal numbers, you will see 101.79.274. IP address is 32 bits, IP version 4. 맞지? 4바이트. 맞나? 32 bits. And if you take a look at inside the TCP protocol format, which is the below, this is where you specify your port numbers. Source port number is 80. It means the 101.79.274.159 is a neighbor web server because I'm contacting through the server through port 80. And it says source port is 80, destination port is 50799. It's probably port number on my machine. My client program using a port number 50799. So I open up the socket. I also need to listen, right? So in fact, I'm receiving packet from the client too. In order to servers to send me a packet, they also need to know my port numbers too. And these are the location where this port 80 is written. It says port 80, 00506개. 8의 2승에. 8의 2승에 오면 뭐지? 80 맞네. 맞나? 내가 곱하기 잘못했나? 8의 2승이면 64. 아, 64구나. Sorry. 그러면은 16을 만들어야 되는데. 에이, 몰라. 50 hexadecimal you convert it that you will have 8이 있으면 64지. 이렇다니까. 0050면 16 진수가 아니구나. 바이너리에 가구나. 아, 이거 덤프 뭐로 받았는지 나 다시 확인해 봐야겠다. 잊어버렸다. 하도 오래돼 가지고. 이게 뭐 하는 거냐면 지금 데이터 이거 받았잖아. 이거야, 이거. 이거야. 근데 이거 지금 바이트잖아, 다. 바이트 그냥 열어보면 그냥 텍스트 파일 열면 뭐로 열려? 아스키로 열리죠. 근데 얼토당토하는 바이트 시퀀스니까 아스키로 열리면 이상한 거 보이지? 그치? 그거 아마 내가 기억하기로는 이게 헥스일 텐데 헥사 코드로 덤프 받을 거야. 헥사 코드로 덤프 받으면 이제 그 부분이 이렇게 보여지는 거예요. 내가 포트 80을 클릭하니까 0050라고 써인 부분이 바이트에서 이 부분 뭐 이렇게 딱 보여지는 거예요. 이거는 이제 얼토당토하는 캐릭터들이 나오는 거고 아스키 덤프라서 그럴 거예요. 근데 카카오톡 같은 거 잡아서 덤프하면 여기 텍스가 다 보입니다. 오늘 뭐해? 저녁 뭐 먹어? 이런 게 여기 다 보여요. 아스키를 덤프하면. Sorry, I repeat myself in English. So that's a hexadecimal dump of your binary information that you try to send from or receiving from or send it to. And then I think on the right side is ASCII dump, but this is binary code is not feasible for ASCII dump, so you will see a very weird characters in it. And if you convert that number into a proper format, then you will have a port number 80. 아마 저게 뭐 엔디안, 느린 엔디안 뭐 이런 거 복잡해. 뭐 수를 거꾸로 읽어야 되고 막 이런 부분도 좀 있어서 좀 틀릴 거예요. That's what network analysts are doing. Sometimes they like to get more ideas on what type of data is being exchanged. They actually do this. They try to guess from a hexacode to the actual code. 그 외 리버스 엔지니어링 한다고 그러잖아. 리버스 엔지니어링 하는 거에 하나의 스텝이 이런 거예요. 리버스 엔지니어링은 exe 파일을 저렇게 헥스로 덤프 받아가지고 어셈블리를 거꾸로 끄집어내는 거죠. 비슷한 거라고 보면 돼요. 얼마나 좋아. 이거 없었을 때는 직접 덤프하는 거 짜서 덤프를 뜨고 매핑하고 막 이렇게 해야 되는 경우도 있어요. 와이어샤크 그러면 또 엄청 좋아요. 오래되기도 했고. 이거 I think the this tool was made initially from some students in graduate studies. 아마 대학원생이 처음 만든 걸 거예요. 이제는 오래됐죠. 오래돼서 사람들이 계속 들어와서 더 좋게 만들고 해서 여러분들 같은 학생이 만든 거예요. 좀 특이한 학생. 일반인은 아니에요. So for fun, they actually have all the protocol formats that you can find on the internet. Pretty much everything. So for fun, you'd like to know actual bits and bytes of the protocol format that you wanted to manipulate, then this is the tool to use to take a look at it. 그런 거 많이 하잖아. 아, 뭐 그런 거. 뭐, if you wanted to figure out whether your computer has a virus worm in it, they usually generate the traffics from time to time. So you kill every other process, you start this program only, and see whether they generate any packets from certain process. And capture it and see whether that's a worm or not. 그런 식으로 테스트도 하기도 해요. 근데 요즘엔 좀 힘들지, 프로세스가 워낙에 많으니까. Anyway, what we're covering in this course is this stack. So end of this course, you'll be able to understand the terminologies on this thing. It says Ethernet, IP, transmission. Well, this is not a, well, if it's a HTTP, then it's probably say HTTP, application layer. So it's just a layering display of the information. So for fun, please do it. So I try to show you where this actual source port number, destination port number are written down. Connectionless demultiplex and recall, create a socket with the local host port numbers. But we all knew this anyways by now. I think I'm repeating myself over and over again. When host receive a UDP segment, checks the destination port and number, port number in the segment, direct UDP segment to the socket. Again, it's looking, finding a right process with the right port numbers, mapping process, IP datagram with different source IP and destination source port number directed to the same socket. We all know this by now. I mean, this one, this step is not so much different between TCP. There is no difference between TCP and UDP. So, things like this. So I give you SP means source port, destination port, DP. So process two, try to send something to the server C, which is IP address is C. So I send, my source port is 9175. I try to find a process that has destination port 6428. I guess this socket opening up, waiting for the traffic that coming into 6428. On the other hand, if this one try to send it back something to this guy, where their location switch, right? From this guy's perspective, this destination is my source port number. So reverse. 6428 is my source port number. In order to find a process and P2, this is the destination port number they told me they have, right? Always client initialize the connection, right? When they initialize the connection, they have to fill out the source port number. So P3 will take a look at the source port number, use that as a destination port number when they try to send the data back. 데스티네이션 포트를 가르쳐 줘야 다시 갈 수 있죠. 근데 굳이 가르쳐 달라고 안 해도 클라이언트에서 서버로 보낼 때, 리시버로 보낼 때, 클라이언트, 샌더에서 리시버로 보낼 때 자기 소스 포트를 표기해서 보내잖아. 다시 받아서 거꾸로만 뒤집어서 보내면 되는 거죠. Otherwise, if there is no port number exchanging mechanism, then there is no communication, at least one, no bi-directional communication between the two. Likewise for this guy. 근데 surprisingly, if I ask you a similar question in the exam situation, lots of people mixed up. It sounds like a very simple step, right? Port number, just make sure you don't mix up with the source and destination from where, from a perspective of where. Is it from PC or P3 or P2, P1? 근데 나중에 보면 가관이에요. Everyone having a same port number. Connection-oriented demultiplexing. So a TCP way of demultiplexing. TCP socket identify a four tuples. Source IP addresses, destination port, source port number, destination port IP addresses, and destination port numbers. Four tuple. Receiver host use all four values to direct the segment to the appropriate socket. We all know that by now. Server host may support the many simultaneous TCP socket. Each socket identify its own sockets, or own four tuple. So it has a slightly different port number, then you have another socket pointing to. 자. 나중에 나중에 안 나오는구나. Web servers have a different socket for each connection client. Non-persistent HTTP will have a different socket for each request. Like these are the maybe one of the examples that you can figure out. Well, when we take the operating system, we've been discussing things like having another process, forking, spawning a new process, mother process, child process. We have discussed that those terminologies, right? So, well, there is another approach is that you can have a multi-thread from a single process. The same idea here, same thing. So if, well, P4, P5, P6 may be a same type of server program or could be different. These three would be differentiated with this source port number, destination port number, source IP, and destination IP. It would be pointing to this guy pointing to here, and et cetera. Or you can have a single process having a multiple thread. But this one, all the destination port number is 80. So it's like a web server with the multi-thread web servers. This is more practical approaches for that part. However, our focus is to try to find the processes with the given port names. So, well, it's not going to make us too much difference for us. Okay, let's get back to UDP. User datagram protocols, RFP 6768. Again, if you wanted to know more operations, detailed operations, or protocol formats, I mean, RFC document is where you should go. Or you wanted to see more of graphical representation of the UDP packet format, I'm sure there are lots of websites that gives you to that. Wiki could be one as well. No frills, no extra operations. Internet transfer protocol, best effort service, UDP segments may be lost, deliver out of order to app, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, sender sends that UDP, it could be arriving completely disorder, 5, 2, 1, 7, 6, but usually UDP doesn't matter, they don't care, receiving end doesn't really matter. TCP, in case of TCP, they actually try to reorganize by asking again and etc. But UDP, no. And one of the most different part from TCP is connectionless. They don't ask for any connection before they send. So they don't check for are you alive or stuff like that. Okay. No handshaking between UDP sender and receiver. Each UDP segment handled independently of the others. Why is there a UDP? No connection establishment. I mean, I think I explained things like streaming application. Well, nowadays, pretty much all the streaming applications also use TCP, but a bit more like P2P fashion streaming site, they used to use a UDP protocol to send out the movies and etc. No congestion control. If you're using UDP, you don't care whether your receiver is out of memory or I don't care anything about the network in the between, so no bottleneck consideration, etc. It's good for the implementer, good for the developer. We don't need to worry about anything else. But it might be bad for the quality of the service, and it may be bad for the network itself. So. So usually UDP packets are a bit smaller than TCP. So if you look at from outside, you see that lots of UDP packets in the network, there's a high chance you will be misinterpreted as a warm traffic, like, because it's sending, disappear, like. UDP more often used for streaming multimedia apps, videos streaming. 아마 YouTube is not. They use HTTP, so means that TCP to deliver the contents. So in fact, it's not a streaming. To be more exact, YouTube is not a streaming. It's more of a receiving the content before they show you. So when you're watching the YouTube clips, then they usually display the ad first, right? Advertisement. And most likely during the advertisement, they download a first portion of the video first. Or sometimes they give you a really high speed at the beginning of the video, then start downloading it. And towards the end, your downloading speed is a bit slower than the beginning. So they give you a little bit of fake. That it feels like we're streaming, real-time streaming. It is actually more of a downloading first, big part, and then they keep letting you to watch. And while you're watching the first half, they're downloading the rest of the stuff. Because YouTube는 옛날 약간 눈속임이 많았어요. It was more like a fake, like. 그래서 앞에 엉뚱한 거 애드 넣어가지고 광고 볼 시간에 다운받아 놓고. 그러면 사람들이 오해를 안 하니까 일단. People do not make a complaint if your movie start. People start making complaint if your movie start and start having a problem of watching it. So they try to use some psychology to trick the users. They feel like they are in the good condition for the streaming movies. VOD도 마찬가지고, your IPTVs, OLED TVs, everything else. They actually use that strategy to do it. So this is UDP segment format, source port, destination port, same. Length in the bytes of the UDP, how many bytes that I'm sending under here. Checksum is another mechanism that try to compute whatever I send, is it gets there in one piece. Checksum. Anybody heard the term checksum before? 혹시 checksum이라고 들어본 사람? 들어본 사람도 있을 거고. I'm gonna go over that. But usually, yeah, you will hear this checksum terms like when you download a large file from the internet, and if you want to verify whether your downloaded files are okay or not, they give you checksum key. So you put your files into some formula, they compute that. If those two keys are identical, it means that your downloaded files are okay. So it's the exact same approach is. They put a checksum up here, so the actual data received okay or not by looking at the checksum later. We're gonna take a look at how to compute a simple checksum at the later slide. And where these UDP protocols are used, DNS, domain name lookup services. Domain name services are, you're asking questions to DNS server from your process, right? When they do that, they don't ask to make a connection to the DNS server. Instead, they just send a query on top of DNS, what is what? And they will reply back with the DNS messages. So, DNS 물어보는 거잖아, IP addresses, whose IP. They use the UDP messages. To do it, a UDP protocol to ask questions and get the answer back. But it says it's not unreliable, so your UDP, your DNS packet maybe get lost. What happens if you don't receive any answers from DNS server? Assuming your DNS server working fine in case of UDP, what would you do? If you're a programmer to write using DNS protocol, to get the URL names or IP addresses of certain website, what would you do? I would simply ask it again, send another DNS packet, and hopefully I get it back. So sometimes when you type it on the certain website, naver.com, sometimes there's a delay. they may be blaming for you don't get your responses right away. Instead, you don't have your IP addresses right away. Maybe there are possibilities that your DNS program ask again, because last UDP packet seems to be lost. Simply ask again until you get your messages. It's good enough. I mean, TCP is more complicated, but as long as you get your answers back, I guess UDP is also simple enough to do it. SNMP? SNMP 아는 사람 있어요? Anybody heard what SNMP is? SNMP라고 들어본 사람? 나중에 통신사에 취직하려면, if you're interested in the jobs in the telecommunication industry, like AT, SKT, or 뭐야 또, LG Telecom, I don't know. LG Telecom doing lots of different stuff, so I don't know. Simple Network Management Protocol, it's what they stand for, SNMP. It's a simple protocol to ask questions to the switches and routers. Switches, more likely. So I ask, sending SNMP packet to the switch, the switch receive this message, reply back to me. Typical messages like, how many packets has been there in your switch interfaces? 그런 거 있지, 왜? When you're using the NAT devices, 뭐 공유기. What do you see when you try to configure your NAT devices? Login, then you can see all the configuration information. 안 해? NAT? Anybody setting up your NAT devices at home? 공유기 집에 없어?
있어요.
셋업 자기네들이 안 해?
해요.
하죠. 공유기 안에 들어가서 보면 거기 잘 옆에 클릭하다 보면 지금까지 왔다 갔다 한 바이트 수 이런 거 나와. 지금까지 왔다 갔다 한 프레임의 개수 이 공유기를 통해서. 그죠? 그런 this number of frames that is in and out of this NAT devices, number of bytes, octet bits that is in and out of this device. I mean, just total number of packets in and out of devices. I'd like to know that information. Then we use protocols like SNMP protocols to ask questions to the switches and NAT devices. So that's why they say simple network management protocols. I'd like to know where my traffics are going in and out. So that's a very simple use of SNMP. Reliable transfer over UDP, add reliability in the application layer. This might be a slightly different aspect from TCP. In terms of TCP, because TCP take care of a reliable transfer, if certain packet is missing, they will ask again. But UDP, they don't do this, right? But you still wanted to add a reliability using the programs that use UDP. What would you do? What would you do? They say, transport layer, TCP can provide reliability, but UDP no. So there are choices that you can add a reliability in the application layer. Means that your program, your application layer program can check whether your UDP packets gets there or not. So it's not a job of UDP transport layer anymore, it's a job of application layer. If you want, you can do that too. So it's a different functions and different layers. 그 UDP로 굳이 하고 싶으면 UDP는 뭘 보냈다 안 보냈다에 대한 레코드를 할 수 없으니까 어플리케이션 레이어에서 하면 돼요. 자기 프로그램 짠 거에서. 어플리케이션 레이어 프로그램 짠 거에서 내가 1번 보냈고 2번 보냈고 그냥 기록하고 있다가 안 오면 다시 해도 되고. 그렇게 하면 좀 뭐 귀찮을 수도 있겠죠? If you need to do that, then why not just use a TCP? Right? Might be easier, just do it. But there are certain cases that application layer, that requires the application layer to do the job for the TCP-like. UDP checksums. Checksum, I explained it briefly. However, this is UDP case, or TCP also have a checksum field too. This is the way of checking the download portion of the data is correctly downloaded or transferred between the two entities. Go detect the errors in transmitted segment. They say example as a flip bit. So the sender send the one,
receiver, receiver 0. It's wrong cases, right? It may be possible because there are some noise at the lower layers. So there are cases that bits are flipped. So you send 101, receiver received 111. One in the middle flipped for some reasons. Then it's not the correct data that you sent, right? How does the sender and receiver figure out the received data is wrong or correct? Simple step they propose is this. Just add everything. Add everything. Let's put the content in 0101 weight, binary numbers, and every 16 bit we add. And then we send this total sum of that number. So before I read this, let me give you my approaches, the dumb approaches. Sender, receiver. Sender are sending things like, I don't know, some data, 3, 4, 7, I don't know, 2. It's a single digit each. This is the data that I'm sending from sender to receiver. So I put that in the datagram and put it in the segment and etc. And receiver hopefully received 3, 4, 7, 2. Order doesn't matter. Okay? But I like to make sure that if I send this, we'll get there. So sender is thinking about the way to verify it. So they actually come up with this approach. 3, 4, 7, 2 at 7 뭐냐? 14. It's a sum of all the data, right? If you make a similar mistake in your midterm, okay. It's okay. Yeah. 더하기가 안 되지. 나는 excuse, I have my excuses of cannot do this because I've been raised in a calculator. So I'm not able to do any multiplication, addition without calculator. 나는 괜찮아. So 16. So when I'm sending this data, I attach a 16 like this. Gets there. So when the receiver received it, they do the same. 3, 4, 7, 2. 16. Compare. This is what sender tell me this number should be 16. I calculated what I received, 16. Okay. So just if there is a case like this become a 5, whatever reasons, if I do this and 0101 ways, 뭐 어떻게 하면 되냐? What's a binary number for 3? 큰일 났네. 오늘 왜 이렇게 계산이 안 되지? 011? 100? 에이씨. Whatever. So somewhere down here, I have a problem today. Become, say, 101. 0 bit become, well, 1. 5, this will say 17. But sender tell me it's a 16. They're not equal. So something is wrong. This is one way to receiver figure out whatever data that you have received is wrong. So you do this exactly same for stream of one digit, the binary numbers. Treat the segment content as a sequence of 16-bit integers. So if I wrote it down 0010. 16 bits, and I keep writing by 16 bits, and I add, oh, 2, no, I have a big problem today, binary numbers. Whatever I have in here would be the sum of all the data contents that I'm sending into. So checksum, addition, in a way, once complement sum of this segment content, big content divided by 16 bits, we add for the older content. And sender puts a checksum value into UDP checksum field.
In the, under the UDP packet definition format, there is a field for 16-bit field for checksum. So I'm adding 16-bit numbers. Hopefully I have a 16-bit later, right? So whatever the sum that I have will be here. So receiver can recalculate this and compare to it. Receiver, compute the checksum of the received segment, computing this part. And check if the computed checksum equals the checksum field value, whatever the sender sent me to. No error detected, yes, no error detected, maybe error, nonetheless, more later. What might be the potential problem of this approach? Yeah. She's right. So let's say 4, 3, 4, 7, 2. Okay. Somehow this become a 4. This become a 6. Then your total is still 16, but different contents. It's a bit more complicated cases. Other cases like, what if this itself got error? 16 becomes a some other value because of the network conditions at the below. So your checksum is wrong, right? There's a possibility, this is wrong, also this can be wrong too, right? So it's not a perfect way of checking stuff, right? So we might need to think of a bit more ways to, we need to come up with another ways to double check this part. So, but I'm sure you get the idea, right? So simple checksum example is like this. Every 16-bit content, So because it's a 16-bit content, I added up, sometimes I might have a carry bit extra bits, right? In this case, they put this, the carry bit, add one at the back. And this becomes a sum of this value. Carry bit, just add it to. Or in some cases, they just simply discard carry bits. 그냥 무시하고. Doesn't really matter. I mean, as long as they agreed upon. So. And they send the checksum for flip bits. 0 become 1, 0 become 1. So if you add those two, I don't know, becomes 1 or something. 저 앞에 있는 거 왜 앞에 주냐고? 그냥 하나의 방법이에요. 이거 무시해도 돼요. You can just drop this too. 어쨌든 간에 캐리빗 1에 대한 거는 합의가 있어야 되잖아. 그치? 이게 하나의 방법 중에 하나예요. 하나 나오면 그냥 뒤에 이렇게 붙여주는 방법. 이 책성, 우리의 책성 계산하는 방법이다라고 얘기할 수도 있는 거고 나오는 거 그냥 무시해도 되는 거고. I think in your textbook they forgot to mention about this. I depend on your edition of your textbooks. So, but I'm sure you get the main idea for checksum. The other examples outside this protocol checksums. When you downloading a large Linux files from the web, they usually give you some hash key as a checksum, right? So you put your content into the hash function, whatever the hash key you generate, you compare whether that's the same hash key of the what the website says. If those hash key equal to each other, then you're okay. So, BitTorrent as well. Distributed hash table, they have their own unique hash key of the content that we're looking for. Should I ask this in an exam situation? This would be a dumb question to ask. I'm just checking whether you know how to do an addition part. But, 내가 물어봤던가? I forgot about all the midterm questions. But if I ask, I will let you know. But even if I ask this, if you got this question wrong, I don't know what to say. Another part, principle of reliable data transfer. This is actually some core part. This is actually lots of people using this way to design a protocol. Design a protocol. TCP is already designed for you. So we can just keep track of how those things are working. If you want to design your own protocols, what are the ways to start? So principle of reliable data transfer. We're going to pretend that we're going to design our own protocol. This protocol will do a reliable data transfer. So some of the functionality of the TCP, what TCP does. And we're going to make lots of different assumptions to make this protocol more robust in different cases. The reason that we need to build this type of protocol is because the channel below is unreliable. Your internet cable, these stuff, are unreliable sources. They may change your data in the way, you might lose some of the data, and etc. So in order to cope with this type of situation, your protocol must be smart enough to deal with the old type of cases, all kinds of cases. So it's a very important topic in the transport link layer, top 10 list of important networking topics. So in the application layer on the top, sending process, send the data to a transport layer, which you assume it's a reliable channel, means that nothing will be get lost or no error messages will be sent. Okay. However, the actual stuff is not the same. Below transport layer, this part may not be reliable. Things may got lost. Right? So somewhere up here in the transport layer must be taken care of. What if that you receive wrong checksum packets? What if your data doesn't seem to be right? What do you do? Like simple ways to look at it is, what happens if the receiver tell me packet you just sent me is not correct? What happens? What do you have to do? What your protocol should be doing? Simple, one of the simple idea that you can think of is you can design your protocol to send it again, if it's possible. Right? Or it's your receiver said, I didn't receive certain packet number 10. Then instead of sending it again, maybe you're gonna tell the receiver that wait for 10 more seconds until, and maybe there's a chance that that packet will be get there within 10 seconds. There are multiple options that you can do in this designing, this protocol design. So it's more like a function. Reliable data, RDT means reliable data transfer send function, get the value data from the upper layer, and then they will make a packet and sending over to unreliable data transfer function because it's interacting with this. Likewise, unreliable data transfer coming up, deliver data up to the application layer. What we are interested is how we can design the between, so we're gonna act like a reliable data transfer using unreliable data sources. Unreliable if it's not getting into you, just like a Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is unstable, right? Unstable. Whether you, why do you think your battery running out so fast? Your smartphones or laptops, if you're connected to Wi-Fi. Because there are lots of error cases. You're fighting for the resources. So it means that unreliable channel like this. Wi-Fi 는 지금 우리가 여러분들 스마트폰에서 와이파이를 패킷을 보내려면 지금 어마어마하게 경쟁을 하고 있는 거예요. 다른 사람들하고. 쉽게 얘기하면 계속 채널을 물어봐야 돼. 내가 보낼 수 있어? 없어? 계속 물어보는 거야. 그렇게 보는 게 좀 더 나을 거예요. 채널 자체가 unreliable하다는 게 딴 사람이랑 같이 쓰는 것도 있고, 그죠? 비어야 내가 보낼 거 아니야. 근데 비었는지 안 보였는지 보려면 계속 물어봐야 되잖아요. 계속 물어본다는 게 뭐야? 뭔가를 보내서 받고 하는 거 아니야. 계속 뭔가를 보내려면 프로세스가 계속 돌아야 되고, 프로세스가 돈다는 건 메모리랑 CPU 계속 먹는다는 게. 그러니까 배터리가 금방금방 타야지. 그래. So RDT send reliable data transfer in that layer in the between. RDT send call from above by application. pass data delivered to the receiver's upper layer. And RDT UDT is sent, called by the RDT protocol to transfer the packet over an unreliable channel to receivers. So when I'm calling the function, I'm sending the data on top of this unreliable. Likewise, receiving RDT reliable data transfer receiver called when the packet arrive on the receiver side of the channels, and it will push it back to the top by aggregating, delivering data to the application layer. That's what's happening. That's what we wanted to achieve. And there will be lots of different assumptions that we have to make. So reliable data transfer, getting started. We will incrementally develop a sender-receiver side of the reliable data transfer protocol, which I'm going to call it as RDT protocol. Consider, at this point, we're going to consider only unidirectional send. Means that only sender can send the data to the receiver. Receiver, at this point, cannot send any data to the sender back. Makes it easier to consider other possibilities. However, data cannot go from server to receiver to sender. There are limited messages that can receiver can send it back to the server, sender. For example, like they can still reply back to the questions like, did you receive this? They can say yes and no. So that's what they mean by control information will flow both directions. So they try to make a small assumption so we can design our channels a bit more easier ways. We're going to use a finite state machine, FSMs, to specify sender and receiver behavior. FSM is what? When you're using the FSM, finite state machine, it's a state. You have a limited number of states, and if you've taken certain actions, that you go to state from state 1 to state 2, right? But when you have all the state, all the actions are there, it's a way of describing how your program works. In the big picture, FSM is a Turing machine. If you have a Turing machine, then you have an algorithm for that, right? Church-Turing thesis were saying for that part. So if anyone remembers from anything from computer science, introduction to computer science. So this is one of the ways to design your algorithm, right? So we're going to use state machines to do that. Simple way to describe our state machine is, as they say,
"학교에 2, 30년씩 계시면 무슨 느낌일까? 상상이 안 가요 아직까지. 상상하고 싶지 않아요."
State one. Well, starting state we usually put it in this way. So state two, if certain actions are taken, certain things are happening, certain event, something happens, I will do this, and as soon as I do this, I'm going to state two, right? Well, it's algorithmic ways. First RDT, first protocol that you design, something called RDT 1.0. So it's a very easy case for assume that there are some very reliable data transfer channels. So there is no unreliable channels. We're going to assume that everything will be get there on time, nothing will be lost. So one of the good cases that would never happen in the real life. So reliable transfer over reliable channels. Underlying channels are perfectly reliable. So I send the one bit, it will get there in order. Nothing was going to change. No bit errors, no need for checksums in this case, right? No loss of packets, nothing will be get lost. We're assuming such a channel exists. And separate FSM for sender and receiver part. So I'm going to use two FSM for server side protocol. The other FSM for receiver side protocols. Sender sends the data into the underlying channel. Receiver read the data from underlying channels. So sender only can send, receiver can only receive. We're still discussing about unidirectional communications, right? One way. And I should have put a mark there, but who cares? So this is, they say, sender side FSM. It says, starting state says, I'm waiting for some data from application layer, because usually I have to put something in. So I'm waiting for the data sender. Sender side layer application sent me something, so I'm ready to send. So waiting for messages from top. I'm gonna call that state one. Okay, when I receive my data from top, what do? I do this, right? RDT send. I need to send it. So I'm gonna call a search function that it will make certain data. This one. So this is event RDT send data from top. So when this happens, what do I do is I'm gonna make a packet so I can send it down to the next layer, like IP layers, transport layers. So I'm gonna create a packet, break it down on the messages. Well, they say they're gonna call certain function called make packets data and what? Then what? UDT send. However, in this UDT, it was referring to unreliable, but we're assuming the UDT here is reliable, right? Packets. This is getting the data from top. This is receive the data, you make the packet, and send it to the channel. Even though we say unreliable, we're assuming this is reliable here. And then what? Everything that I send from here will get there. Sender doesn't need to keep track of anything else because it will get there. We have a guarantee. So after I send this, I'm probably waiting for another message from the top. That's all I need to do because I don't need to communicate to the receiver at any end. So I only need one stage. So when this happens, go back up, wait again. So I should write this on top of these lines, go back up. What about receiver side? Receiver side same too. Whatever they received, it's guaranteed to be correct. So I take it, bring it back up to the top, make the messages again, bring it up, extract the packet, deliver data. RDT received the packet. When this event happened, what the receiver side process are doing, get the packet's data, reassemble it, deliver to the upper layer, done. And this is also waiting for next set of data should be sending from the sender. Makes sense, right? There's nothing to worry about here because it's guaranteed to be correct all the time. No unreliability channels. Your protocol. Receiver side protocol. Sender side, receiver side, I don't need to draw it down. So. Actually, this is how the people design your protocols. So if you're working with a certain software that help you to design protocols, instead of coding, you're actually drawing this type of stuff. In the PC, you can draw circles and bars. And then if you click some button later, they will translate this into a C code. But just for the outside. Inside, you have to fill it up. But they will make rough classes. So they will create something called stub. So empty program, but they actually give you all the function names and parameters. for you to use. 그리고 이제 그 안에 거 짜면 돼 있어. And then you actually go inside and start programming. And then you put whatever you finish your program, you do a simulation. There are tools that you help you to design the protocol like this. In case of TCP, well, there wasn't a very good simulation tool back then, but if you want to design a new protocol, or if you want to make a changes to the existing TCP protocols, this is probably one of the ways that you can test. So if you download those simulation tools, you can download the TCP behavior FSM like this. And then you decide to add extra stuff like this in your own actions, and but don't do it. It's never going to work. It's a very, if you actually see the entire map of TCP behavior, you'll be amazed. It's really complicated. There are lots of people, they claim that our TCP is better than the current TCP. They do a simulation, they try to compare a performance between the two, etc. 많이 해요. Many of them are not lying. 사기들 많이 쳐요. 왜냐하면 시뮬레이션에서 하면 내가 조금만 이렇게 바꾸면 내 마음대로 할 수 있거든. 그래서 나는 프로토콜을 새로 디자인했다는 논문이나 이런 건 잘 안 믿어요. 하도 사기들을 많이 쳐서. 실제로 해보면 잘 안 돼. 구현에서 잘 안 돼. 근데 이제 검증을 받은 애들은 진짜 잘 된 애들도 있어. 그래서 잘 찾아보면, 리눅스에도 잘 찾아보면 내가 지금 쓰고 있는 TCP랑 좀 다른 버전을 쓰고 싶으면 커널의 컨피규어를 바꾸면 다른 TCP를 쓸 수 있어요. 좀 더 빨리 왔다 갔다 하고. Anyway, that's later. So RDT 1.0, I designed my first protocols. What about second setup? RDT 2.0, bit more advanced protocol. Now we're going to assume that there is at least a bit errors. At least a bit errors. So packet will be get there, no loss of packets, but still there are going to be errors cases. So I'm guessing that I must be doing something else in this part, sender and receiver part as well. At least for the part that, I don't know, computing for the checksum, I might guess. The question is how to recover from errors. How do humans recover from errors during conversations? Bit errors. How, can you think of a situation that same things apply for the human communication? 그런 거겠지. There are cases that you try to...
Party?
Yeah, party situation. Yeah, it's exactly what I was going for. loud music, you try to talk to some girls or guy. You can't hear it. You ask again, what did you just say? You guys pretending that never been to a club or party situation here. Yeah. 한 번도 안 가본 사람처럼. You have a nice innocent face that you guys never been to those parties. But you usually ask, right? The word, the part of the sentence that you didn't hear, you ask again. Can you repeat? That's how human beings are communicate. What if we use the same approaches for the protocol design? So this is the RDT way of asking questions again between two protocols. Underlying channels may flip bits in packets. So checksum will be required to make sure. The question, how to recover from errors? Something called acknowledgement, ACK. Receiver explicitly tells the sender that packet received okay. So when the sender send the packet with the checksum bits, and the receiver check it with the comparing to the checksum bits they received, and then they say it's equal to whatever the sender sent me, they're gonna let the senders know this is okay packet. I'm gonna call that as ACK messages. And I specify another message. Receiver can also tell the sender that the packet you just sent me having a bit error, NACK. Receiver explicitly tells that the packet has an error in it. And probably just wait for whatever the sender is decide to do. Natural way of thinking is if the sender receive a NACK, sender might want to send it again. Just like human way of communications. Take care. Sender retransmit the packets on the receipt of NAC. When sender receive a NAC, they will send that corresponding packet again. So let's try to integrate this mechanism into a RDT 2.0 FSM. New mechanism in RDT 2.0, beyond the 1.0, receiver feedback, control messages, ACK and NAC, receiver to the sender. So in this way, we're going to assume that control messages, ACK and NAC, receiver can send it back, right? But data still cannot send it back. Well, it's relatively simpler than I thought, right? Let's see. Same thing. The starting state always same, waiting for something happen from the application layer, receive a message. Okay, when I receive RDT send data, I'm gonna create a packet, send packet, make a packet with the checksum. With the checksum, I need to compute the checksum at the sender side too. And I will form a packet and send it to the receiver. However, I might need another state. Well, it's different from 1.0. If nothing happens, then I could move it back to the first row. But in this case, I might need to handle such cases that ACK and NAC are coming in. So I might, there is a necessary for this part, second stage, waiting for NAC and ACK. So in this case, we design it for like, until I receive a message from receiver, I would not send any data yet. Either that's ACK or NAC. So I'm waiting for either ACK or NAC. So there could be two different situations. What happens if I receive an ACK? What happens if I receive a NAC? What happens if I receive an ACK? Everything was okay, right? It means it's going back to RDT 1.0. I go back to my process, waiting for another message from the top. What if I receive a message for NAC? In this case, I try to send it again, the same packet that I sent before. So that makes it simple. Two state may be good enough to do it. So when I receive a NAC, received packet is NAC. So you can look at it like an if statement. If RDT received packet and received packet is equal to NAC, then I'm going to do this. What? Send it again. UDT send whatever that I've sent before. And then what? Because I send it, I'm waiting for ACK and NAC one more time. So I can be in the same state. If everything was okay, if the packet that I receive is an ACK, so I could simply go back to the starting state. Actions taken? No, nothing. I don't need to do anything else. So they use the notation for E? No, nothing. Starting, wait for messages, wait for neck and neck. Is it? Sender side, so this is sender side algorithm for the part. Assuming there is only bit error in the case. Receiver side, what? You have your answers right here, but. Hmm.
처리하는 컨벤션.
처리하는. At this point, RDT 2.0, the protocol that we designed, they don't check for that. But actual TCP operation, they might count that. How many times that I do it? I'm a retransmission too. I think they might count that. How many times that I've tried. Or I'm not so sure what happens if the number of trials over the threshold, but yeah. You did, in case of actual TCP FSM, there might be a cases that keep track of how many times that I've tried.
나중에 해야 돼요. 그래야 또 보낼지 그만둘지 결정할 수 있으니까. What about receiver side? One state, I'm just gonna copy it down. If received packet, okay. Corrupt means something is wrong with the received packet. Then what? Checking for corrupt. Corrupt is true, then sending NAC. I'm just making my own rules here. And wait. If it's okay, if packet okay, received packet okay, then what? Sending what? ACK. But still, we only need one state because you keep waiting for the messages to come. I would expect like this very rough format, but I would like to you guys to know the actual steps like this. Okay. This seems to be easy because I give you the graph first. Without this FSM, if I ask you to design your own FSM for RDT 2.0, I would see all kinds of FSM coming from you. We have what? 30 people, 40 people in this class, I will probably receive 40 different looking FSMs. This is one of the optimized way of representing. Ama, if I ask you to do that, I'll probably see lots of cases for the sender side, starting ACK, NAC, going back like this. Ama, if I don't give you this, naturally you'll be focusing like this. I mean, it's okay, as long as it works. I mean, it's just difference between short program and bit longer program, but they are working fine, right? But since we're giving an optimized solution for the protocol design, well, maybe it's a good idea to know in this way. So. People who made this, it's very smart people, designing protocol like this. Imagine that you try to build your protocol in terms of coding. You start coding right away. Yeah, I don't know how you can come up with all the test cases, all the cases. Lots of if statement I can expect. So only thing that's left is you translate this FSM into a actual coding later. So this is showing you step for interacting between two FSM machines, right? Waits for the message, and then sender sends something to the receiver. It goes to this part and check whether it's not corrupted, whether it's okay. It was okay. Do I send the ACK back? Sorry. It's ACK. That's so as soon as they receive it, it's taking this way, go back to the start state. Likewise, it's keep repeating itself. Next scenario. Go back and wait, send it again. Hopefully this time it's on ACK. And then I go to the next stage. What might be the potential problem with this? Well, first thing I probably notice is it's going to be very slow. Send one, wait, send one, wait, send one, wait. If you're packet exchanging using TCP in this way, we might need an hour to surfing on the web for a single website. What about others? What happens, ACK and NAC itself has a bit error. The receiver sends an ACK, but in the between encounter a bit error, so it becomes a NAC. Then it will probably send it again. Because it's a NAC, sender will take a look at it as a NAC, send it again. And this current FSM, receiver doesn't know what to do when they receive the same packet twice. Because we didn't simply tell them what to do yet, right? Or it was a incorrect packet, but somehow ACK packet goes to the sender. So receiver ending up with the wrong data set. So their message cannot be recovered on the top, right? This is the same problem of what if your checksum itself has a bit error, right? Same thing. Hope you can see that they start adding more problem into more and as we increase the version of the RDT protocol. Eventually, this is become similar to the TCP protocol transfer, but much simpler format of TCP though. I think I'm gonna stop here today. Any other questions? I will go back to this next week. Any other questions for today? 빨리 집에 가고 싶지? So I will call your attendances and then I will collect your assignment one today. And your solution will be up on the Hanyangin this week, so you can check it. And hopefully you can start working on your assignment 1.1. And I would, sometime next week I will try to give you assignment two. Okay, attendances.